Hi, welcome to the 2019-2020 Liquid Fuel Engine Test Stand, or LFETS, capstone handoff. We did the liquid fuel engine, or LFE, yesterday, and today we're doing the test stand. There is already a 45-minute presentation on the interwebs of these guys talking over some slides, and so we'll assume that you've watched that somewhat first. Somewhat assume that. And go from there. All right, guys, take it away.
All right. I guess I could start today like I did yesterday. Could just do a brief walkthrough of what's in the folder tree, for lack of a better word, and then
If I may, I would love to see. Let's start where we should have started yesterday, which is the 10,000 foot view.
Oh, okay, sure. So the I guess I'll take a stab at it, and I'll let anyone else jump in at that point and provide some extra. So the 10,000 foot view here is the test stand is designed to have a pressurization source and a fuel tank and an oxidizer tank, and be able to control fluid and pressure flow to an engine. The test stand is sized for the approximate flow rates up to a 10 kilonewton engine. However, it could be used for anything smaller than that as well, with some modifications, which we can talk about later.
Sorry, is that actually true? I thought we decided to go to stick to a 6 kilonewton.
The engine is 6 kilonewtons. All the parts on the test stand are sized up to 10 kilonewtons in terms of tubing sizing and valve sizing.
Okay, good.
I don't think there was a substantial cost difference to order like a larger size valve. Mike, Jake, Steve, Zach, anything you'd like to add to the 10,000 foot view that I've butchered?
I just wanted to add that one of the things that remains to be tested with the test stand is the mass flow rates. And I know you guys designed a lot of that into the pencil, and there was plans to have some metering in these lines as well, and they're designed into the CAD. But I think that's an important part to make note of for when the thing gets built, that that's one particular item that a lot of the other folks that we talked to, they talked about swapping out some of their cavitating venturi flow meters, maybe even having like a set of flow meters that you use for a certain mass flow rate, and then you swap them out for a different engine size. So you would kind of right size what metering you're using, and you'd have a little toolbox full of those to run different engines on. That's probably something long term that should be planned for. I don't think those things are super duper expensive. They were like $1,500 from Flowmax. But probably plan on that. There's two flow meters already existing here, but they're probably a little bit too small to run any of these things, even the 6 kilonewton engine. So I think the test stand, when it's first run, is probably going to rely on the pintle for its flow throttling, and then moving forward, you probably want to throw those meters in there.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah, I wanted to add
Go
one
ahead.
more thing. Sorry, Mark, I just
No worries. Go
remembered
for it.
one thing we didn't get to in the capstone either. We just kind of relied on it working, was anchoring the test stand, and we kind of relied on, when you run it, you'll strap it down or put something on it. But I mean, 10 kilonewtons is a lot of force, so you put a ton and a quarter on it and push on it, it's probably going to want to flop over. So that might be another to-do item on the test stand, is make sure the thing doesn't tip over when it's fired.
We're just going to put it in the back of someone's truck. It'll be fine.
Yeah. Make
Yeah.
sure their insurance is up to date.
That's a good point. I'm sorry, did I cut someone off? Okay. I think that that's a good point about the test stand falling over. The solution there, I think, also depends whether being able to fit it through a single wide doorway remains a like important consideration. Basically, like, where does it get stored? If the answer is inside of like the rocket room, then it, whatever solution is designed for keeping the test stand from falling over has to be collapsible, right? Such that it still fits through a doorway. If you look at like other test stands built by rocket or built by like university rocket clubs, the sample size isn't huge, but they seem to be like mounted inside a shipping container or attached to a trailer. So like there's inherent stability built into that by just bolting it down.
A side note on this, Julio did say he would like to help design and build anything that could help stabilize the testing.
Yeah, that sounds great. I think that's a great summer project.
I mean, you could even put it on like a Harbor Freight trailer or something, and it wouldn't cost that much money to do, you know, or get it on a slightly more fancy trailer. But you'd need to have a place to park it. So if you guys could find a place to park it, you know, permanently, that it's not going to get destroyed or stolen, that'd be a good thing to do. I know a lot of the other university ones look pretty nice, and that would have been an easy way to transport it. It's pretty darn heavy. It's going to be a heavy thing to move around.
Unfortunately, we are always the underfunded stepchild of all rocketry projects ever, and so the thing where we can park it inside our room is actually important. So I don't think you can get a trailer. We've tried this before, for the record, where we tried to get something that we could park and leave it. Yeah, it doesn't go well. I don't know what's wrong with the transportation people at PSU, but they don't like, there's no place to park stuff. So
maybe anyway, maybe focusing on making it modular and making sure that it can be quickly bolted and unbolted. You know, I like to use Unistrut, and a lot of projects you could use Strut to put stuff like that together, and it'd be strong and able to be unbolted and rebolted together real easily.
That would be fantastic. That's essentially that, and some strapping I think would be really good. But luckily that's a future capstone or a future thing. Hopefully, I'm not going to say this summer, because there's no way it's going to happen this summer, but maybe this fall. All right.
Okay, I guess I can do the quick where did we hide stuff overview, and then I think Saul has to work Friday morning, so I don't think he'll be joining us this morning, unfortunately, but I can walk through a little bit of CAD later as well. I started SolidWorks, so it's hopefully won't take too long to spool up. And okay, well, I'm also getting a soil delivery this morning, so a truck just drove by. So I actually might need to bail for 5 minutes here to go make sure they dump the soil in the right place.
I can help with the folder structure and stuff
too. Okay, all right. Oh yeah, literally. Okay, I hate to do this, but can I bail for 5 minutes, Mike, and then...
Yeah,
I'll come back.
I'm glad this is recorded.
Okay, yeah. I mean,
We got you on film, brother.
Yeah, let it be known that Mark's also gardening during this.
You can't. Oh, no, you can't
tell.
The botany
nerd now.
Can we see the giant red truck?
Oh, yeah, we can see it.
Okay.
Get going.
All right. Okay, I'll be back in a minute.
All right, thanks, Mike.
All right, I can share my screen here. All right, can everybody see my screen?
Yep.
Okay, so similar to the liquid fuel engine, out in the 2019-20 LFE LFETS capstone folder, we've got a subfolder for the liquid fuel engine test stand. And we've tried to organize this folder so that all the different major data stores and everything for everything we got for the test stand are kind of categorized out here. We start with the material data sheets. In this folder, we've got every data sheet for all the different instruments that we looked at, including some indexes here, and any kind of reference material we need for the different parts that were selected for the test stand.
Awesome.
So there's also some subfolders in there for some stuff we looked at for nitrogen regulators. I think we selected the Concoa reg. Here's a quote for the Concoa reg. This one has not been bought yet, but this was the high flow nitrogen reg. And then there's some details in here for the thrust plate as well. And I can't remember if the, yeah, here's the FC23 load cell that we selected to replace on the thrust plate. So all the materials, all the data sheets for everything we bought should be stored out here for reference. This ordering bill of materials folder has quotes and other ordering information for what we bought. Here's an order status sheet from back in March. But if you want to look at the prices and quotes and stuff, they're all in here too. So these were the three sharp ball valve with actuators that we bought. Those are here. There's three of those purchased. We got some quotes for aluminum stock. I think this is more for the engine. And rod, the check valves. I think we might still have some outstanding stainless steel check valves that haven't arrived or have arrived and haven't made it.
I believe actually I have them.
Okay, great. Just all the stuff going everywhere due to COVID. And then we got some quotes for high flow regs from Swage Lock, but we decided not to go with those. We decided to select the Concoa instead. I think these are pretty expensive, $2,200 each. So that's our ordering folder. Pretty much the main design folder here, besides the SolidWorks stuff, is the P&ID and HAZOP folder. So this contains the final versions of the process and instrumentation diagram. And Mark's already been in there tinkering for next go around with some changes for with the result of us talking to the folks at Purdue. And he's added a few things in here. We didn't include this in the capstone just because we weren't going to go back and redesign again in the capstone. But I think there's mostly adding a couple of transmitters. And I think the suggestion was to add another vent line. So materially, that's not a huge add other than buying a solenoid valve. But I'm sure Mark will follow up on that. Some of the main deliverables out of the capstone, though, and we did this in the fall term, was the HAZOP report. And a HAZOP report is not something you really learn about in school, but it is it's a super useful thing that we do in industry to make sure a system is designed to operate safely. And so that was one of the first things we did with this project. We took the original P&ID. And then we went in, we put together this HAZOP report, which involves going through every single node in the system, in the P&ID, and evaluating it for every single type of failure that could possibly happen on that. Sorry, I gotta change my default account here.
Mike, is this the same as a FMEA, failure modes effects analysis?
Yeah, pretty close.
Okay.
HAZOP's more of an OSHA term, and it's a code requirement for industrial piping systems and that sort of thing. But yeah, it's totally, the scope of it's pretty much an FMEA.
Yeah. Okay.
So we wrote a report based on this. The Capstone team put a lot of time and effort into this in the fall term. This is pretty much the main deliverable of the fall term, but it basically broke the P&ID up into systems called nodes in the HAZOP. And that was basically the fuel, the nitrogen purge, the LOX, and the LOX tank fill line. So four different major systems. And then evaluated each of those for all these different criteria. So high pressure, high temperature, high flow, low flow, and other things that you work through when you're going through these different types of operating scenarios. And then for each one of these, came up with notes and consequences, safeguards, and action items. So looking at high pressure in the fuel line. This first one here is PRV1 failed wide open while SOV1 is closed. So you see the nitrogen pressure, full pressure, and then I think our solution is we have a relief valve in there. So, and we make sure that the lines are rated to that pressure. And we had some action items to follow up, investigate an additional regulator. One of the things you typically do with a HAZOP is at the close of the project, you go and resolve all these action items. And we didn't really go back and do that because there wasn't much that didn't get already resolved anyway. So this is kind of a point in time view of the PNID. But it's also a good thing to look through very good reference about the project, about how different failure scenarios are handled. So if anybody has a question about the test stand moving forward, wants to know, hey, what did they think about this? What did they think about what happens if this solenoid sticks closed? This can be a reference document where the team goes back and looks to see what we thought about that scenario. And this should be a pretty exhaustive look at what could happen in the system.
This is great. I actually am shocked I didn't know you guys did this. This is really, really, really good and really important. And when we're done with the new PNID, we will go and re-update this.
Yeah, that'd be great. And I mean, this can totally be a roadmap. And, you know, I'd be happy to give some advice too. I'm still around.
Thank you.
This is one of the things I do for work. So, you know, it's pretty important to make sure that you've got the right relief valves, you've got the sizing correct, you've got pressure ratings that are correct. And yeah, if you end up changing anything or you know, making big material changes to the system, you kind of owe it to the design to go back and update the HAZOP when you're done. Yeah, the team, the many pizzas were consumed during the creation of this. And yeah, everybody really, this was the first part of the big part of the project for me. And actually I was super impressed by how everybody was involved and how much we got done out of this. This was a good report. Usually you have to beat people up quite a bit during HAZOPs. They start falling asleep. And so here was our original PNID and the nodes, the color coded nodes that were identified. So, and some more references. So I think the source of all that stuff in there, sorry, my accounts are always default to my Gmail. The sources for all the tables are here in this Excel spreadsheet, so this can be used as a reference later on too.
Oh, did you just copy and paste the cells into there?
Yeah, they it's just possible. Got pasted into the report, yeah.
Okay, so the actual source document is the spreadsheet. Okay, good.
Yeah. So if you could use this in the future as framework for another HAZOP, this report, and then just to paste the tables in. The tables were all just done in a spreadsheet.
Okay.
So during a HAZOP, there's usually somebody who's the scribe, quote unquote, the scribe, and they usually use like the things I've been through where you've got thousands of these things you're doing. There's special software that you use that makes kind of scribing it quick, but the cheap and easy way is to put up a spreadsheet.
Cool.
So the HAZOP report was a very important part of the design. There's some state diagrams in here. The SAR one, that's from December. That might be a little out of date. And we'll rely on SAR for their portion of things. I think we've got the PDF copies that were the official reports. There's some valve references and other sorts of stuff. To just all the stuff in this folder is to drive the development of the PNID. And then there's the older versions in here too, just to look back through history. Next is a software folder. And the only thing we really have in here that's special software that isn't something that's easily available for PSU is this Pentair PRV2 size program. This is something that's freely available by Pentair, who makes relief valves, but it has some really useful tools in it that allow you to size a relief valve. And let me see if I have it. I'm on my work laptop right now. Let me see if I have, I don't have it, but I can switch laptops later on and show if anybody's interested. But inside this app, it allows you to fire size tanks and determine flow rates for tanks. So in the relief sizing report, I went through and sized reliefs for the fire case on both the locks and the fuel tank. And you can program this to look at boiling liquid evaporative vapor explosion parameters. And it'll tell you, like for the liquid oxygen tank, we're assuming the tank is insulated with a certain amount of insulation, but given a fire case, what is the boiling locks in there gonna produce as far as a flow rate that you would need to be able to relieve? So it's not a very big tank, so there's not a lot of locks in there, but it's still gonna boil and it's gonna increase in pressure, and you need to have a relief that's capable of moving as much volume as it's creating while it's boiling. So this is a useful application to use for that. If you wanna use Pentair relief valves too, it'll tell you what relief valve to use. They're probably outside the price range of anything you guys wanna do with this. And they're made for really big situations. So I think the smallest relief valve in there is probably a 3/4. There's a test stand CAD folder, and this is basically, I think it's the whole CAD zipped up and then a link. I think the CAD should probably remain on GitHub, and I'm going to rely on Mark and Saul.
I just did a pack and go there because we wanted to share that with the gentleman from Purdue.
Perfect.
Without having him download several gigabytes of old GitHub repository stuff.
Yeah. And then lastly, we have a calculations folder. And so this contains some calculation sheets that we use to calculate sizing for the regs. And this sizing calculations is a little bit of a Swiss knife for calculating flow rates given a CV. So there's a flow rate calculator over here. A lot of these components that you buy are specified with a CV. They're not specified by flow rate or anything. And that's basically a measure of the geometry of the valve. And its CV is usually in gallons per minute, water gallons per minute. But you can use this to calculate the flow through flow of a gas through a valve using some calcs over here that we ripped from Swage Lock. They have really good reference material for this sorts of thing. So the reference is up here. These are their calculations. We use that to give us a flow rate in standard cubic feet per minute. That's using this units factor up here that adjusts it based on a CV and inlet pressure and an outlet pressure. And so that's very useful when you're trying to size a component and they only give you the CV. So.
And that is a publicly available document from SwageLock, so we can refer to it without any paywalls or anything.
Yeah. Yeah, they have tons of really useful information available on their website, even if you're not using SwageLock stuff. Two bending radiuses, calculations for tubing pressure, that sort of thing. We've got liquid flows in here that we use for the locks and stuff. This doesn't really take into account any kind of weird cryogenic boundary effects or anything like that, but it's good enough kind of for this type of work. For blasting at it with a slug of nitrogen as it fires out a rocket nozzle, you don't have to get too picky. And then some other conversion rates. So this is mostly just like a doc full of conversion values. And if anybody is looking to size things or why we chose 1/2 inch or why we chose 3/4 inch for things. That's it here. We didn't update this highlighting, but we did choose 3/4 inch for the fluids and 1/2 inch for the gases. Just based on design criteria of less than 100 feet per second in the gas lines transporting gases and less than 30 feet per second-ish for things moving fluids. So we figured 31 and 32 at the 10 kilonewton case was fine for the locks and IPA flow. We're just trying to keep that down so you don't end up with excessive flow velocities in the lines, leading to big pressure drops. And especially like for locks, you don't wanna auto-ignite anything with it because you're adding too much friction.
For example.
Yeah, for example. PSV sizing report is the other important thing in here. So this has got sizing criteria for all of the pressure safety valves. So called out by name, so PSV1, PSV2. This is using Generant's calculator. They provided the relief valves. And so a lot of times we rely on the vendors to provide the calculations for their reliefs because they have geometry specific calculations. So Generant gives us this little calculator that tells us what the flow capacity is. And we always calculate the relief valve at its set point at pressure. So what's its capacity? 850 PSI for PSV2 and for, I think we also had 850 PSI for PSV1. I'm sorry, we had 650 for PSV2. This is a typo. Calculations for 650. Then we got the case for oxygen boil off on the LOX side. That's it just sitting there. That's going to be much less than the failure case for a failed regulator upstream. The boil off rate is going to be much, much less. And then we got the tank fire sizing. So this is the output out of that Pentair tool. You put in the geometry of the tank. What the ends look like. This is basically just figuring out the surface area of the tank for the fire case that goes into this wetted area here. And then it spits out our required flow rate in pounds per minute. And then we calculate that the pounds per minute from above in the relief valve calculation. So the thing about the LOX tank is if there's a fire and it causes it to boil, it can boil and increase in pressure so fast that the pressure increase can increase and just blow up the tank. And that's called a boiling liquid evaporative vapor explosion. They're very, very powerful and it's a very deadly thing. So that's why relief valves are typically sized pretty large on a cryogenic liquid tank. Or any liquid. If you look at a propane tank, one outside your house or something might have a little tiny pop-off relief. But if you look at like a real industrially sized propane tank that's sized for a fire case, it might have two relief valves and they might be 1-inch relief valves. They're pretty big to make sure that if there's a fire case, this thing doesn't explode. I've got some videos of that at work. I've been trying to find them. I'd like to play them for the team. They're pretty big explosions.
Yeah.
I could probably look on YouTube too. There's probably something on YouTube if you search for Blevy.
There's also that really great Mythbusters video where they blew up a water heater.
Oh yeah. Yeah, the thing about a liquid that has the capability to boil into a gas with a high vapor pressure, the pressure can increase logarithmically, you know, as it boils. And so you can see these fantastic increases in pressure inside. Then we got our nitrogen reg here. I think this relief has not been bought yet. PSV3 still remains to be bought. I think we were going to buy that right as we were waiting to buy it until we had the upstream nitrogen regulator sized. And then COVID hit. So I think that was the last one that didn't get bought. And I think this is a selection report for the PSVs. Yeah. So this is all the different reliefs we're looking at for the nitrogen case. So this probably just needs an update. If you guys decide to buy the Concoa regulator, make sure the relief valve is sized for that. If you choose something else, you can follow these sorts of same things. We had a hard time kind of finding a cheap relief with the correct capacity for the nitrogen side. Cheap was kind of hard to get. And that is the liquid fuel engine test stand folder. And Mark, what do you want to do next? Do you think we want to show CAD or?
I was also thinking that I was going to maybe take a quick walkthrough. I pulled up a few links for like fittings and I pulled up the swage lock tube sizing, like wall thickness guide.
Oh yeah, good.
I don't think that'll take too long. Then we could maybe move into CAD, maybe just sort of get for posterity some of the parts that become confusing, like the sizing of tubing versus the sizing of pipes.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Okay. This is where we remember you have to hit share twice. This is a Swage lock document as well. Basically for selecting tubing. And if we scroll down, one of the things it has is it in addition to other stuff, it has like allowable bend radii and also dimensions specifically for Swage lock fittings. I'll talk about fittings in a second. Let me find stainless steel tubing. Okay, so one of the ways to size, to figure out what thickness tubing you need is if you know what your pressure, what your working pressure is, you can find your, think in here, you need to select ones that are not gray. So for example, half inch tubing, if you select 0.049 inch wall thickness, that has a maximum working pressure of 3,700 PSI. For 3/4 inch tubing with a wall thickness of 0.065, that has a working pressure of 3,300 PSI. I don't know if you talked about it, Mike, already, but one of the, I guess, nice things about most pipes, valves, fittings, everything else is they all come with pressure ratings. So someone else has figured out things like factor of safety as it is rolled into that number. So when you, if you know the pressures of specific sections of your tubing, you just need to make sure all of your components have pressure ratings greater than or equal to the maximum pressure that section will see.
Go ahead. One more thing about that, Mark. So your line is going to carry a pressure rating that's the lowest of all the components that are attached to it. So if you got a 500 PSI rated brass valve on it and you got 3,300 pound tubing, obviously your rating is going to be 500 pounds. There's a couple important notes about this. The shaded gray ones, that's where SwageLock has said the tubing is too thin to be swaged down.
Is that what that is? Okay.
Yeah, without creating defects around it that would create a leak. And it's based on helium service. So helium's going to squeak out of anything that's the smallest possible leak you could find. So they're just saying for gases, don't use anything in the shaded regions. In practice, there's not a big difference. There's a small difference in price, but for the quantities of tubing you guys are buying, you're talking about dollars and not hundreds of dollars. So there's really no reason not to go with like 049 wall half inch or like 083 wall or 065 wall 3/4 inch. The 065 is probably more common to find. And that 3,300 pounds is more than anything you'll see on the entire test stand. So you're good to go. The other thing I wanted to point out about SwageLock, if you use any of their fittings or Parker's kind of the same way, if you use the AN fittings, that Mark's going to talk about the 37 degree fittings, the fittings carry the same rating as the tubing that they're attached to. So they're pretty much geared up to carry the same pressure rating as the highest thickness of tubing that's in there. So you don't typically have to worry too much about the fittings. It's probably good practice to check the pressure rating on the fitting. I just know that when you buy SwageLock, they specifically say all the fittings are rated to whatever the tubing size they're attached to.
And I think the same is true for the flared fittings, the AN37 fittings as well.
Yeah.
One of the most confusing things I think that tripped us up for quite a while is that tubing and piping are sized differently. When you have tubing is sized at its outer diameter. It's all imperial as well. That's one of the other challenges to trying to do everything in metric is you can do it all in metric and then you have to convert back to imperial units in order to purchase anything. But for example, a half inch tube is half inch outer diameter. So the inner diameter is smaller. A half inch pipe is the inner diameter. So the outer diameter is larger than half an inch. That creates a lot of confusion and potential areas for error, especially when you're talking about ordering fittings. So many of the connections, most of the connections for especially tubing to tubing, or just most of the tube sections, we've specified as a 37 degree flared fitting, which is commonly known as an AN 37 or a JIC 37. Those are close enough to being the same. They're all compatible. There's some minor difference in terms of like material or defects or something like that, but I think it's a quality control difference and not an actual compatibility difference. So these fittings are commonly available. They require, the way they work is you'll take your piece of tubing and using a flaring tool, you'll flare out the edge of the tubing, or you'll install a collar and a nut first, then you'll flare out the tubing, and then the flare will seat onto the curved section, onto the conical section of the fitting itself. The collar will seat down, and then the nut will tighten and compress the tubing against the conical section of the fitting.
What is the sleeve usually made out of?
The sleeve is usually made out of, I'm pretty sure it's gonna be stainless. I think you can order it in other materials. So this is for stainless steel tubing. Hold on. Okay. So here is a four tube outer diameter.
Yeah,
as an example, yeah, here's a 304 stainless.
Okay.
And so this is the piece that's going to go between the nut and the fitting itself to compress the tube from the back. And yeah, they're 3,000 PSI. And I think that's fairly standard across most of the AN37 fittings, at least those that are available from McMaster and some other websites. So that's going to be plenty for anything that the test stand will see.
Do we actually have a flaring tool?
I think so. I believe we have a flaring tool. If not, I don't think they're especially expensive. It's effectively like a clamping mechanism that clamps the end of the tube and then has a threaded piece that allows you to thread like a cone down into the top of the tube and deform it outwards. But that's a good question. I believe we own one. I believe PSAS owns one.
Okay.
I think it's in the closet in the rocket room in the LSAT's closet.
PSAS also currently has some number of flared fittings already, although certainly not enough for the whole test stand. What's good next? So the one thing I did want to call out here that caused us some confusion before we sort of really drilled it into our heads was that most valves come with pipe tap threads on one end is one way to order them. And so what you need then to attach it to a flared fitting is you need a flared to pipe adapter, which presents you both numbers on the same part. You have tube sizing and you have pipe sizing, and those are not the same. A half inch pipe is much larger than a half inch tube. So on a site like McMaster, for example, you have your tube size here, and then you choose your pipe thread size on this side. And so it's going to be, and so you have options as well, where for the same half inch outer diameter section of tube, you can order it in any size pipe threads from half inch all the way up to 3/4 inch. So that's just a thing to double check what size you need before you order them, because for example, you're starting to get into like $15 to $20 to $50 per fitting. So it could be expensive. I pulled up the CAD. I guess questions on tubes or fittings before we take a look at some CAD? Okay. Trying to think what's going to be most maybe an idea. So here's the PNID that the CAD is based on. It's currently a little bit behind the like draft version based on some conversations with Chris Nilsson from Purdue. But this is sort of the last version that has been reviewed. So that is what the CAD is currently based on. I think one of the sort of immediate term future PSAS projects is going to be to update that, is to finish the new PNID, do a review of it, and then update the CAD to match. But if we start sort of over in here.
How did the call with Chris go yesterday? Were there changes?
We rescheduled. We were scheduled for Monday, Monday. Yeah.
So if we start sort of at this end and work our way towards the right, the first thing I can call your attention towards, oh my gosh. Is some of the nitrogen. I'm trying to think. I believe the pressurized nitrogen will come into the system right here. It'll then get split. Thank you. It'll then get split three ways. One of these, I don't know which side this is going to feed. One of these are maybe not the pressure regulators will actually order, but one of these pressure regulators will feed the fuel side. One of these pressure regulators will feed the oxygen side. In sections where there's just straight tubing, we haven't necessarily drawn in the pipes itself. That should be relatively straightforward just by measuring it within the CAD to figure out how long to cut the piece of tubing. One of the things that we noticed while working on the test stand is valves are big and the test stand is relatively small. So we've used, hopefully this will turn out to be a good idea and not a terrible idea, but we've proposed using a number of these square manifold blocks as a way to really condense the number of, condense and put a lot of pieces into a very small space with a minimum number of connectors between them. There might be some interesting challenges about like fitting wrenches in there, but I think we can work through it. So this will include things like a pressure relief valve to protect the downstream valves, pressure sensor as sort of placeholder, a small valves to allow the pressure regulator pressure to be set. And I think potentially a plug. So anyway, so this one on top, this is actually one of the existing regulators that we already have. This is one of the small ones. And this pressure regulator is going to be used to drive the pneumatic, to provide air for the pneumatic valve actuators. That's sort of one of the conceptual changes that we made this year from prior years, is moving away from electrically actuated or custom actuators and moving to pneumatic actuators.
It's a good idea.
I hope so.
One of the relief valves all the way up. It looks like they vent way above the frame.
Yeah. Mike, is there a good reason why? I know we talked about that, and that's kind of standard practice to vent relief, to put a section of tubing on the top of a relief valve to vent it away. Is there a strong reason for that?
Yeah, many of these are going to be venting oxygen vapor. And so the idea is to get the oxygen up and out of the test stand, moving away from it if the relief is going off, rather than like venting down low or at a point where the vapor cloud can envelop the test stand. So if it decides to catch fire, it's going to catch fire up in the air.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so maybe I'll just look at one side here and hopefully this isn't too awkward to look at. But so the pressurized gas is coming out of this block manifold. And then this one, for example, I think actually runs into the oxygen tank. So it's kind of going crosswise. We'll just have to make sure we label all the parts really well, so that like the correct section is touched when you mean to work on that. But so it'll come out. It runs through a large pneumatic actuated valve here. which is going to be the main pressurization valve, through a couple of check valves. It looks like we make a big old loop here, which I think is to allow for cooling. And then, hope I've got this right. I got that right? Yeah, okay. So we've made a big old loop here, which we may or may not want to keep as is. I've sort of lost the thread here. Yes, okay, great. So we put in some large loops to allow for expansion and contraction as the temperature changes. But then we've got, now we're just above the liquid oxygen tank, and we've got another pressure relief valve, a section of tubing over to the primary vent valve, another pressure sensor, and then into the top of the tank. Very similar on the fuel side as well. So in the tank is obviously going to be the, in this case, liquid oxygen. And what we'll have here is underneath the tank, you know what, I could probably, if I did like that, there we go. Now it's straight up and down. So underneath the tank, like we discussed earlier, all the tubing on the top is a half inch outer diameter tubing for the nitrogen gas. All of the liquid tubing below is 3/4 inch outer diameter, except until where it splits into three sections, for example, to feed the fuel to the engine. Out of the bottom of the LOX tank, we have a T which goes one way into a pressure sensor. Then we have some sort of a, this is as well a function of how compact the test stand is, sort of a serpentine route to get to, where are we going to? The main valve here. So the main valve here is a large cryogenic valve. All of the cryogenic valves have these tall stems on them to allow the valve to operate and prevent both freezing and leaking. One of the challenges is definitely fitting, because this is a 12-inch stem, and then this is not exactly the actuator that it comes on it, but if you've seen the valves that were delivered, they're pretty beefy. So we sort of made a serpentine path over here, and then one of the things that was pointed out to us is if you have originally we were going to have just a straight section of tubing into the back of the engine. It was pointed out to us that would prevent the load cell from measuring the thrust properly, because part of the thrust would just push on the solid piece of tube. So we've put in a final loop here, which again may or may not be the final configuration of the exact tubing, to just try and allow for a little bit of flex. And then that goes into the back of the engine.
I think the one takeaway here too is that when the tubing is fit up for this, anything that's in the cold portion of the system needs to have some loops added to it. You know, it needs to at least have some offsets so that it can contract and not pull on the fittings.
Yeah. I think one of the things we will need to do, which I don't know personally how that exactly is going to happen, is do testing with liquid nitrogen. After water testing, also do testing with cryogenic, but with liquid nitrogen, to make sure that when everything chills down, it doesn't leak. And also just to see how everything behaves as it's both cooling and, you know, as it's chilling down and as it's warming up, to make sure there are no issues there.
Yeah. One thing too, when you guys do cool this down, you'll notice that it looks like it's going to have a fog coming off of it, and it's going to have this vapor cloud around it. And it can be hard to tell what is a leak and what's just normal, like condensation in the air around it. But rest assured, you will know it's a leak. So if it looks like it's just a little bit of a vapor cloud, it's just a vapor cloud. If it leaks, it's going to leak, and you'll see a big jetting cloud, and you'll see it'll make a lot bigger. It'll make a really big cloud. So for the uninitiated, it can look like it's leaking, but it's probably not.
Yeah, I think sometime last year at the end of 2019, Jacob Tiller shared a video of his work, and it was pretty clear when the test stand he was working on the I think it was they were doing, I don't know, maybe liquid nitrogen testing, but when the liquid nitrogen hit the spout and it stopped being vapor and it started being liquid, it was a pretty dramatic increase in the size of the cloud.
Yeah, for sure.
So I think, yeah, in comparison to sort of what appears to be the standard for test stands, it seems like most other test stands are sort of stacked, are much deeper. So you'll have like your tanks, and then you'll have your bank of valves, and then you'll have like your, you know, like your blast plate, and then you have the engine. And so everything sort of goes more or less linearly along the way. One of the things about this test stand being as narrow as it is, or as sort of thin as it is that things kind of need to loop around a little bit more. The other portion of this that we can look at real quick is the fill node, which I think will need a little bit more work. This was maybe, it's a little bit more work to go in here, but, and this also is a section that I think might need some updates, but there'll be one extra actuated valve down at the bottom here, which is where we proposed putting it, which will allow for the connection of the LOX Dewar and then allow filling of the tank. So it'll go up and into this T-fitting or into this cross-fitting below the tank and fill the tank from the bottom.
I'm curious to know, going back for just a minute, about how screwed you think we are because of the form factor of the test stand, of this kind of weird, shallow, tall thing.
I don't know, to be perfectly honest. Like, I don't know, for example, if we need to, okay, so for example, on the fuel side, it comes down out the bottom, and then it makes kind of okay, how do you get from, you can't see where I'm pointing at the screen, how do you get from the bottom of the cross fitting into the back of a large valve, which needs to be located sort of in a, such a way that you can strap the, that you can mount the tubing to the test stand. And so it's like, okay, well, how about this serpentine kind of path that kind of turns a couple of corners?
Yeah.
And what I can't tell you, I just don't have, maybe Mike has more experience and could sort of have a feel for it, is what kind of effect that'll have on like pressure loss through the system.
I think the way that's designed, I mean, I don't think you're going to have a huge problem with, you're going to get a lot more delta P across the Flomax cavitating Venturi that's right there than you are off the sweep on the line. When I was looking at this, I think actually one of the biggest concerns I would have is just the weight of the thing once it's all put together and trying to manhandle it around. And it might be something as simple as just looking at in a next capstone or something, or whoever's working on it, can you just cut the thing in half and bolt it together on site, you know, weld a couple mending plates on there or something with some bolts, and then you got one half that's got the tanks and one half that's got the valves down below. It might be a way to lift it on there without it, and make it a little bit easier to move around. But the one thing I wanted to say was, these guys spent an awful lot of time on the CAD and everything, and the capstone spent a lot of time doing this design. I think you're at the point right now where I would say send it, you know, start building the thing, and then try to avoid a redesign or anything like that. Cause you could spend a whole nother capstone trying to make it a little bit different, or, I mean, maybe it'd be better to have the tanks further away from the rocket. You know, if an oxygen line breaks during a test fire, this thing's probably going to catch on fire. You've got adequate relief capacity. I would fire this thing up and work on building it. But my biggest concern would just be the weight of trying to move the thing around fully loaded like this. It's hard enough to move around with just the two tanks on it and nothing else. Yeah. You know, we're talking about probably adding another several hundred pounds worth of stuff to it. So you might just look at something like that, but I would say make the solution simple, you know.
Yeah, I don't want to redo this. I just want to make sure that we're not going down a dead end. And it doesn't sound like we are, so that's great.
No, No, I think the stability wise, you know, maybe put some outriggers on there to that you can bolt and unbolt, and that'd be it.
Yeah, I definitely want to second that as well. As a general recommendation. And I think even if PSAS builds this whole thing up and finds, oh, there's some reason why the current frame is like unsuitable for use beyond, you know, initial trials. I think the majority of the components here could be reused. I think were you to say strip it out and build an entirely different frame, or like mount it on a trailer or something like that, you could reuse tanks, you could reuse valves, you could reuse all the fittings. You'd sort of just be into like several hundred dollars of new tubing. So I don't think it's lost. It's not a lost investment, even if this frame proves to have drawbacks that are not not surmountable.
Yeah.
Thanks.
I guess, are there questions? Not sure where we should go from here.
We don't, a couple questions. We don't have the pressure sensors or temperature sensors in this, do we?
That's a great question. We do have placeholders for all of them where they'll be located. I can't tell you these are exactly what they're going to look like, but for example, the nitrogen, the gas sensors. So this is like, sorry to flip back and forth quickly. We're looking at aux, it doesn't matter. Okay, so we saw regulator. Ooh, I don't know if we have that one. Okay, so we saw regulator and then we have pressure sensor.
Yeah.
So that, for example, oh, nope. Is right here. So this is main regulator, and then right after the regulator we have a block and a spot for a pressure sensor.
The asking stupid questions, but we can buy those blocks off the shelf, right?
Yes. Yeah, these are commercially available.
Okay, they're not in the PNID though.
They are not in the PNID. That's kind of a weird thing. Like the PNID is just sort of like all the components and how they're strung together.
And not the piping. Yeah. Okay.
Not exactly the piping. And you see like a connection point where you're like, okay, so here's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 things that needs to connect to one sort of node. Node's not the right word, but like one connection point. And that was kind of why earlier versions of the CAD, we sort of strung together sets of T-fittings or cross-fittings and realized that that was a lot of potential points to leak. I believe if you just say block manifold.
Yeah, okay, great.
Yeah, it's an off-the-shelf part.
And on the PNID, it's typical to only really show like flanges on the PNID. You don't normally see a lot of other fittings on there. It's usually meant more of a, this is more of a, it's something to design the project on, and it's something to coordinate specifically like with the instrumentation folks on. That's why all the PTs and TTs are on there.
No, that's good. It's a schematic, and I understand that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think the same way that like an electrical diagram might not exactly look like the board layout.
Right.
Yeah. I was going to ask Mark just before you go on, did you guys, I had to drop off yesterday, but did Saul have a chance to show how to generate a 2D drawing out of the catalog?
No, he didn't actually. I don't know if that requires that. I'm doing this locally on my computer. I don't know if that requires the tubing plug-in.
Yeah. Maybe we can get him to do like a 5-minute video or something.
Yeah, that's a good idea. We could certainly ask that.
So one of the things Saul was doing out of this, Andrew, was he can generate like a 2D fabrication drawing for each one of these sections. That would be where these blocks and everything would show up. And like what we would do with a drawing like this when we send it to a vendor or something is we would do up the CAD model and get everything figured out, you know, as far as routing and everything is concerned, and then start spitting out these 2D fabrication drawings. And they would tell where the bends need to go, what parts need to go on them, what fittings need to be bought, and lay each one of them out. And it looks like Mark's actually getting her done.
I think this is not going to work though. No, this is okay. So there might actually be one that's already.
So this is a dumbass question.
Yeah.
You can have people bend the pipes for you?
Yeah, you maybe. Can send it to Albina Tube Bending and they'll bend the pipes for you. But this thing is probably a lot better done in person.
Yeah, I was going to say, we'll probably do it by hand, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, if you were doing like a big industrial project and you had, I take that back. If you're building a heat exchanger and you had like a tube bundle that you were building and it had 85 different U-bends in it, and they all needed to be perfectly done with no wrinkles, and then it needed to be tested as an ASME pressure vessel, you might send it to somebody like Albina Tube Bending and have them bend it up for you, and they'll ship you back all that whole tube bundle pre-bent. And then it's usually like long or they'll have a certain termination on the ends so that you can take care of mating it to whatever it needs to go on, like a tube sheet or something.
Okay, so
this is a fab drawing. Sorry.
Yeah, I was just going to say, one of the things that we took advantage of this year. Oops, that's. Never mind. Damn it. I just didn't wait long enough. SolidWorks specifically has a plugin for tube routing specifically, which is not included with the student version that we can download on our own computers, but is included with the version that is in the engineering building computer labs. One of the advantages of doing that, there's a few tricks to it, and honestly, it's been a little bit since I figured out how to do this, so it took me a second to remember how to do that. But one of the primary advantages is that if you have the tube routing built in, it will generate a sort of three-dimensional view of the section of tubing automatically, or quasi-automatically. It becomes, I think, the default drawing view. And what that's going to allow is it's going to allow, for example, here's one of these serpentine sections of tubing, and it'll give you the dimensions to allow you to then go and try to bend. I think it might also give you it's not going to let me go over. I thought it also gave you the size, but I might be mistaken there. Anyway, it'll let you figure out, okay, what's the unbent length of tubing that I need here, and then sort of show you all the dimensions for how to bend it in a sort of concise three-dimensional view.
Good.
We didn't go through and generate that for everything.
We're not done yet. I don't think we should do that until.
Yeah, right. It seemed like wasted effort before we were felt like we were like, yes, this is the section that we want to go ahead with. Another advantage of bending in-house is that there'll probably be some issues where we'll try to put a valve in a spot where we thought it was going to fit, and for whatever reason, it's like not exactly where we thought it was going to be. Bending in-house, we could just sort of adjust the way the tube is bent. If we sent them all out, we would kind of be locked in, and it might just require some more like rework.
It might be good to get the strut down and then get the valves down and all the major components down, and then the work parties can just go one by one by one by one, start stitching it all together.
Makes sense.
That's kind of how we were going to do it before we got locked down.
I think so, yeah. I think that's about what I'd wanted to cover. I did want to throw out any other Capstone folks here. Is there anything you want to add, sort of thoughts or recommendations for future work or whatever?
No, I don't think so.
Oh. I'm good.
Great. This is the one capstone that made me cry that you didn't have access to the lab.
Yeah.
The other ones did all right, but this was a little terrible for that. So I really appreciate you guys doing the CAD and getting it to the state where it is. I feel like we can take next steps now.
Also, just for the record, I think we still have valves in Helen's living room.
That's probably where the sharp valves are.
I believe those are the valves that are in her living room. So there's, you know, a couple thousand dollars worth of parts sitting in, I assume, a closet in her house. One of the reopening tasks is going to be finding all the stuff.
Yeah, no, that's really true. And reorganizing, we're getting the rocket room is upgrading in July, so we're going to have more space.
Oh, wow. Great. Okay. So I'd be happy. I'm around. I'd be happy to help move stuff, whatever's needed.
And stop the recording and say congratulations to you guys. You've done the handoff. That's awesome. Does anybody else have any questions or any comments before I kill the recording? All right.
You guys are fantastic.
Yeah, nice work. Thanks.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.